I'm going to talk about the research that I did over the summer with Dr. Shrum via Scope on illuminating the space of beatable load runner levels produced by various generative adversarial networks. Excuse me. So the motivation for our work was previous work that had been shown that video game levels can be generated by generative adversarial networks. One of the struggles is that sometimes the structure of the levels within the games are difficult because they need a traversable path, or in the case of Load Runner, it needs a traversable path to every gold, because the goal of the game is to collect all the gold to win. And if there are missing ladders, ropes, or ground tiles, then it can make even a simple level unbeatable. So some previous work that inspired our work is Dr. Shrum's work in generating Mario levels in 2018. And then there was work generating Doom levels in 2019. And then using a variant called the ToadGAN, there was research that was able to create Mario and Mario Kart levels, generate. And then additionally, the scope before, the summer before, Jake Gutierrez and Dr. Shrum had work that combined GANs and graph grammars to create Zelda dungeons. So before we go into generative adversarial networks, we need to talk a little bit about procedural content generation. And it's pretty much just a algorithmic way of determining rules and levels for games to save time and money during development. And so what we're doing is procedural content generation via machine learning, which is still experimental, not used in industry, and it's data-driven. It learns, which means that it learns from the data of a training set. So GANs are capable of generating video game levels from learning structure based on the original levels, and it can generate convincing fakes. This visual over on the right, this visual here on the right, is one of an example of the earliest research in GANs that generated fake celebrity faces. And the surprising thing is that none of these people are actually real. They're all generated by GANs. So a little bit of background on Load Runner itself. It was released on Atari in 1983. And it's a platform game that requires the player to traverse ladders, ropes, and ground, all while avoiding enemies to collect all the gold in the level in order to win. So a little bit more on the GAN training. As you see right here, this is a representation of the first level of Load Runner from the original game. And then here is a character-based representation by the that's located in the video game level corpus, which is a repo on GitHub. And once we, each of these characters correspond to a tile. So you can see these hashtags are the ladders and the enemies are the E and so on. Once we have that representation, we can easily convert it into JSON, where each of those characters is represented by a number. And then we can compile all of those to create our training sets. So what's happening with the generative adversarial network is that it is a game between the generator and the discriminator, where the generator wins, hopefully, if you train well. So the generator takes a latent vector of ambiguous size, and it's just random, and it generates a fake.
Really quickly, please be sure to make sure you're muted if you're a viewer. Thank you.
Thank you. and it passes that output into the discriminator, and the discriminator determines if it's real or fake. And at the same time, levels from the training set are also being passed in to the discriminator to help train the weights. And once the discriminator can no longer distinguish between a generated level and a level from the training set, is the ideal time to stop training. So we had a number of training sets for each GAN, as we talked about before. The first one is the first 5 levels, and then the first 20, and then the first 50, and the first 100, and then all 150 levels. And then there's a special GAN trained with levels that depict words. So when I talk about the words present GAN later on, these are the levels that were a part of that training set. Also, we used map elites to simulate evolution. And what map elites does is it explores more of the latent space in order to fill all the bins based on the dimensions that we define, which I'll go over in a little bit. The next part was actually solving the level. And to do this, we used an A-star algorithm. The first challenge that we encountered was that the digging action was way too expensive to track every tile that was dug. So to counter this, we just made it so that if you have a place to stand, meaning a ground tile on the right or the left of the place you want to dig, you are able to go downwards. And another thing is that the enemies are not modeled in this. This is because if you can traverse the whole level by itself, you should be able to do it while avoiding enemies as well. It might just take you a little bit longer. But one of the things that was detrimental about that is that it made some of the levels from the original game not be able to be solved because they require enemies to bring gold down to you. Which was a little bit weird. So now I'll go over a little more about the specifications of the experiments that we ran. So the map elite spins, as I talked about before, were defined as the percent ground, the number of enemies, and the number of treasures. Also, the fitness was found by the max of the A star length, the A star path length, and the connectivity. So if a level was not beatable, it would get an A star length of -1, and the connectivity, which is the amount of the level that is traversable, lies between 0 and 1 because it's a percentage. So that score will be higher if the solution path length is -1. Also, all of these are averaged over 30 map elite runs. So it's not just one run of each of them. So to go over the results, the on 20 levels GAN generated the most beatable levels. Not only did they have the highest number of beatable levels in each bin, they had the highest percentage of beatable levels overall as well. And additionally, although the words present GAN did not perform well in beating, in generating beatable levels, it did generate the largest variety of levels, as we see by this curve right here on this plot. So next we're gonna go over this heat map, goes over the map elite spins. So, but digesting this chart is a lot. So each column is a different GAN, and each row is a different range of ground. So, for instance, this row that's highlighted right now is every level in that in those bins have 0 to 10% ground. Additionally, there are dimensions inside of each of those boxes for the treasures and the enemies. As you get higher in the boxes, there are more treasures, and as you go farther to the right, there are more enemies. And here's a little bit closer view. So each one of these rectangles represents a single level that is placed into a bin. As you can see, the solution path length, it represents the colors that the boxes are. And as we saw in the plots earlier, the on 20 levels and the on 50 levels have the most light colored squares, which indicates a high solution path. And the words present GAN has very few instances of light colors, and it's mostly dark purple because a lot of those levels were not beatable, meaning that they used connectivity for their fitness instead of the A star path length. Additionally, to look at the levels more directly, we saw three types of levels that were generated for the most part. Copies, levels that merge different structures from different levels together, and then completely chaotic levels. As you can see over here, this level is almost an exact copy of level 2 from the original game. I think that this rope right here is the only difference. And moving over here, this level actually merges together three different kinds or three different elements from three different levels. This AL right here comes from one level, this A comes from one level, and this DJA comes from one level. Additionally here, as you can see, there's not much structure to these levels. There are gold pieces that cannot be reached right here. Like you would need to have a ladder here or a rope coming across. And then there's this gold piece just hanging out, floating in no man's land. And then in this level, there are pieces of this ladder missing, which make you not be able to get to this one. So a little bit of discussion about this. If you want, if your goal is to produce the greatest diversity, you want to use the words present GAN. If your goal is to get like consistently beatable levels, you want to use the on 20 levels GAN. The on 100 and on 150 levels GAN performed poorly in both respects of diversity and beatability. But this is possibly due to mode collapse, which is essentially where the GAN gets stuck generating one type of level and doesn't expand. So some future work that we want to go over, or that we want to expand to this, is instead of doing the first 5 levels and the first 20 levels and the first 50 levels, maybe just do the same size training sets, but have random levels in each training set to see if that brings about some greater diversity and quality. Additionally, we want to see other groups like words presence that share a common structure. Also, to say for space efficiency, we put a search limit on A star, but removing that search limit could reveal that even more of the levels that were originally deemed unbeatable are actually beatable if the algorithm has more time. And then the last thing is a new binning scheme for map elites besides percent ground, number of treasures, and number of enemies. This could be like maybe number of ropes and or number of ladders or something along those lines. Lastly, I would like to thank the Scope program, the donors, and all of that. I wouldn't have been able to have this opportunity without them. And then finally, I would like to thank Dr. Shrum for helping me through all of this. Are there any questions?
Lots of virtual applause. It's a very cool presentation.
I have a question.
Yeah.
What would you say was like the biggest hurdle to overcome while you were working on this?
The A-star model for sure. yeah, we actually like at one point we actually started working on a traveling salesman problem to try to improve it, but that ended up performing worse than the A-star algorithm, so we just ended up using the A-star algorithm. Any other questions?